Two R's make an H in Portuguese?
In Portuguese. Ferrari is Fahari.
Well, that is super whole. That didn't make any sense. Guys, how you doing? This is Isaac. This face doesn't do anything for me, Anderson.
This is Tyler.
Is that it? Is that all you're going to do?
That's all I'm going to do.
Dang, I thought you were going to do so much more than that. But anyway.
If you watched Aladdin, I would have said a lot more.
Okay. Well, guys, this is a movie show where we talk about movie news.
Movie reviews.
And everything in between. And I think we should just get this out of the way, out of the bat. I did say last week that we were going to review Aladdin, but we had Mr. Tom Proctor. I had got to sit down with him and interview him over Skype. And we had already settled the date was May 30th, and I totally forgot about that last week. I think I mentioned it the week before, but that doesn't matter. And so Tyler saw Aladdin, and I didn't. Mm-hmm. So, sorry. Tyler, what did you think of Aladdin, real quick?
It was garbage.
Yeah, okay, time for movie news. Anyway, speaking about garbage, Ford is also going to go against Ferrari. Not now, but somewhere in the past. But it's going to enter our TV screens next year. And Christian Bale and Matt Damon is going to be in it, and it's been directed by Mr. James Mangold. That's right, a Ford versus Ferrari movie right here on your fingertips.
Is it a death fight?
It is not a death fight, but it's a fight for the best, I guess. I don't know. The movie could be about that. I have no idea.
Oh, which one's cheaper? Obviously, the Ford's a lot cheaper.
Obviously, the Ford's a lot cheaper, but the Ferrari sounds better. I don't know. Tyler. So, James Mangold is directing this, by the way.
Yeah, he's the one who did Logan.
He did Logan. He made Walk the Line. He's made 310 to Yuma.
The Wolverine.
Yeah, he made the Wolverine. This is him right here. He always looks like you messed up his order at McDonald's.
He looks like Jimmy Kimmel's unhappy brother.
Yeah, he always just kind of looks like he just got a call that, like, he had to go into work at 3, and that's like 11:45, and he's already sat down at the restaurant. And his waiter comes up and asks him, like, is everything all right? And he just kind of has that face. Yeah. We can go all day about James Mangold's face, but what do you think about this movie?
I have to say, from the bottom of my heart, I really do not care.
You tend to say that a lot.
But well, I mean, Ford or Ferrari, I don't care about either.
Well, this is not just about Ford versus Ferrari. This is about a specific race where Ferrari was like, it won all the races. And
they got beat up by a Model T.
Yeah, basically. this movie is going to be based around basically the Ford company and like Henry Ford II basically trying to make a car that can compete and actually beat the Ferrari. And
he made the Viper.
Yeah, and this guy right here, not Christian Bale, but the character he's playing, his name's Ken Miles. Do you know who Ken Miles is?
Ken Miles, I'm not sure.
Ken Miles was a racer, and he actually died in 1966 when this movie takes place. So I think this might be his death is what we're going to see on screen. I don't know. Maybe it's a different race.
No, we're watching Christian Bale die again.
Yeah, I know. Mm. First you see his career die a little bit in Terminator Salvation. Now you might see him physically die.
Well, I mean, I heard he's going to be in the new Dune movie. They said he put on 36,000 pounds to play the giant worm in it.
That would I would not put it past him.
Yeah.
But what method? But speaking about method, Matt Damon is also in this movie. He's playing a guy named Carroll Shelby, and who was also a racer for the Ford company.
Matt Damon.
It's weird. Like, can we go back to Christian Bale real quick? We have one of our awesome volunteers, Brian, over here. Thank you so much, Brian, for helping out. But Christian Bale, I don't know what it is. Christian Bale always transcends himself and always like he just looks like someone different. Like his face, obviously, you can only do so much with your face and with prosthetics and stuff like that. But he always his posture's different, and the way he walks is different, the way he talks is different, the way his eyes move are different. And go back to Matt Damon. Matt Damon's basically Matt Damon. In every single movie he does.
Matt Damon.
He's not much of a character actor. He's kind of a one-trick pony, but he's really good at doing that.
Matt Damon.
I had that written down right here. Tyler will do Matt Damon from Team America.
He did write it down, too. Matt Damon.
Tyler, any final thoughts on this?
Are we going to have to see it?
Most likely. Mm. I mean, James Mangold, okay, Christian Bale and Matt Damon. That sounds like a pretty cool movie.
I don't like Matt Damon, and I don't like Ferrari either.
Well, you can root against them, and you can root against Matt Damon and go for Christian Bale and hope he doesn't crash.
Okay.
Hope you can rechange history. But speaking about rechanging history, Sylvester Stallone has come out with a new Rambo movie, Rambo Last Blood.
A.K.A. Almost Last Blood.
A.K.A. Rambo Menopause.
If he, oh well, that's bad. But that is if this makes money, then we'll probably see another one.
Yeah, that's the way it usually goes. So Mr. Sylvester Stallone himself, first off, what do you think about Sylvester Stallone? Are you like a Sylvester Stallone fan? I never ask you this. Do you actually like Sylvester Stallone movies, or do you like, or are you kind of in the camp 15, like you think he sucks?
15% of his movies.
15% of his movies?
Yeah, like I do like some of the Rocky movies. I do like the movie Never mind, that wasn't Sylvester Stallone.
Oh, man.
I was about to say Hairspray, but that wasn't
him. That was John Travolta. That? Can we play the trailer? Actually, I want to go through a few things in the trailer real quick.
Well, it had Amanda Bynes in it. Oh, it had a big thing for Amanda.
Oh yeah, Amanda Bynes was in it. Yeah, and now she has a big thing for substances.
Cocaine.
Well, that allegedly, even though she confirmed it on Twitter. But anyway, so this is the trailer right here, and this movie is directed by, I don't think I have a photo of this guy, but his name's Adrian Gunberg. Do you know who Adrian Gunberg is?
Adrian Gunberg. Is he related to Sylvester Stallone?
No, he's not. He is a guy that directed Get the Gringo with Mel Gibson.
Oh, I saw half that movie.
I think he might be some sort of like, think he's like a cinematographer or something like that. He worked on a bunch of different Mel Gibson movies. I think he worked on Apocalypto, and I think he worked on one of those other movies that he made. I don't know. That's like one of the only ones I really know of Mel Gibson besides that and Passion of the Christ. He did a few other things in other movies, but this movie is directed by him, and Sylvester Stallone obviously has a heavier hand in it. And this one seems to be like he's protecting a little Mexican girl or something like that in his house, as what the plot synopsis said. But it's just a set piece so Sylvester Stallone can kill a bunch of Mexican gangsters.
It's just about Sylvester Stallone, Rambo being the last corner of the world, I guess.
Is it going to be like Rambo border control?
He was in Asia. He was in the Middle East.
He's Mexico, yeah.
And then he was in Washington, Oregon, wherever that was.
I don't remember. The last one came out 10 years ago, didn't it?
Yeah, that was Vietnam. No, Burma.
Yeah, I don't know. I watched 6 minutes of it. And I'm I'm done. I didn't need to watch anymore. The camera was a little bit too shaky. As far as this movie, as far as, let's just go concept, because the trailer is pretty much finished. Basically, you're going to get a Rambo movie, essentially. Do you want to see another Rambo movie?
Not really.
Why not?
Because I feel like it's been used up.
Yeah, Rambo is kind of a tired old franchise, Rambo is basically Commando with Sylvester Stallone.
I kind of feel Rambo's heyday was the 80s. That was back when we had action stars.
Yeah, and especially the big muscly guys now, it's just Grandpa's got a gun,
Yeah.
It always feels like that to me, although he was really awesome in Creed and Creed 2, he was used appropriately in those movies.
He was the grandpa who was training the next generation. Unless this is about Rambo teaching a little Mexican girl how to use a bow and arrow.
You don't know that. It probably is. Knowing Hollywood now, that's probably what's going to happen. It's going to be a soft reboot, and the little Mexican girl is going to become the new Rambo.
Rambonita?
Oh, you racist.
Yes. Not yes on the racism, but yes on the Rambonita. That would be a whole new film franchise.
Rambonita. Any final thoughts on this? Tyler Nita.
I'll probably not watch it.
Just like most Americans.
Yes.
But speaking about most Americans, Knights of the Old Republic, a Star Wars franchise, a.k.a. a Star Wars story, a.k.a. a Kathleen Kennedy joint, is going to be a movie.
Oh, no.
Yeah. So Knights of the Old Republic, in case you don't know, is a video game that came out, I believe, in the mid to late 90s for the computer, and it came out in different versions for different... for different platforms. It basically takes place in the First Order of Jedi in Coruscant, and the Sith coming up and the Jedi having to protect the galaxy. And it's basically how all these Jedi started. It's a bunch of big space battles. And
Kathleen Kennedy's at it again.
Well, this happened before Kathleen Kennedy. These two characters...
No. I'm talking about she's making this into a movie. They're doing more Star Wars spinoffs.
Well, yeah, I was thinking that too.
Kathleen Kennedy is like a pimp who is pimping off Star Wars to anybody who's going to watch it, and she counts her money at a little dingy hotel.
I feel like I've told you that. That's a Red Letter Media, Mike Stoltz.
Red Letter Media. He, as soon as he said that, he summed up the whole Star Wars franchise.
Yeah, I know. It's very, very true.
Thank you, Mr. Plinkett.
Yeah, Mr. Plinkett himself, Mike Stoltz, said that. As far as this movie, a lot of people have been clamoring for this movie.
Yes.
And granted, I've, I don't want to see another Star Wars Solo movie. I absolutely don't want to see that. But
oh, you said Solo. Yeah, nobody wants to see another Solo movie.
Well, a standalone film. I definitely don't want to see another Solo movie. But as far as the standalone film of this kind of concept, maybe? I mean, these video games are really highly regarded and everything, and there's been different versions of them. They're very cinematic. But
Solo was highly regarded. We saw his Solo film.
Yeah, well, I mean, the biggest thing is, like, we don't particularly need this. If you want to, like, part of the fun of Knights of the Old Republic is that you get to play as these characters.
Star Wars fatigue.
Yeah, you get to go into this world and you get to play as these characters, go around, and, you know, you get to fight, you know, Darth Face, or whatever his name is, Darth Bald? What's his name, Darth Revan? Yeah, Darth Revan, that's his name. That's a really popular one. Everyone said Kylo Ren looked like when Kylo Ren became a big thing. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, if you're going to do this, really embrace the fantasy, really try to give us something different and something cool, not stupid C-SPAN politicky kind of stuff, like prequel muff. But, yeah, this is a different version of Knights of the Old Republic. They're, like, they're brothers, and they go, like, to two different paths, I think. That was a pretty cool trailer. But, Tyler, Knights of the Old Republic movie. I know you said you don't want to see any standalone movies, but if they're going to make this hell or high water, what do you think? Do you want to see this, like, if they're going to make it?
No.
Why not?
Star Wars fatigue.
Well, like, have you ever played Knights of the Old Republic?
No, I don't play Star Wars games.
You don't play Star Wars games?
Okay, was it on the 64? It's not on the 64.
I don't think it was on the 64. It was more of like a computer-based game. It was like
then
an internet game.
I didn't
game.
Play it. If it went on the 64, I didn't play it.
Okay, well, if they're going to make it, and someone should make this movie, okay? So this is basically like a big Lord of the Rings kind of fantasy thing in the Star Wars world. Who should direct this?
Luc Besson.
Why?
Because I like saying Luc Besson.
Well, okay. In case you don't know who Luc Besson is, he's the guy that made The Fifth Element and the Valerian movie.
Yeah, Valerian in the House of
what
Thousand
a
Corpses.
Hit.
Thousand. What was it? Valerian in the House of a Thousand Corpses. What thousand? No, that's not it. That's Rob Zombie.
I get Valerian in the place of Cara Delevingne's career. I think.
Yeah.
I think that's the name of it. But anyway, I don't know who should direct this. I have to look a little bit more into Knights of the Old Republic. I heard someone say Denis Villeneuve. But he's directing good movies, so I don't know. We'll cross that bridge when we get there. But speaking about crossing that bridge, Sonic the Hedgehog is apparently going on a big old break so it can fix its face until 2020. And guys, don't think that's going to help. Tyler, what do you think?
I don't think so either. If they can get Sonic out of the Uncanny Valley.
Okay, so... in case you don't know, Sonic the Hedgehog, they filmed the movie. The movie's done, okay? And they released a trailer, and this is how Sonic looks, okay? Now, Brian, just from your facial expression, do you like this? Yay or nay? No, and Brian's going like this. Yeah, he doesn't look anything like Sonic. He actually looks a little creepy. They try to make him more realistic looking, and it looks like it's...
horrifying.
It's terrifying, yeah. And... They said they're going to make him look more cartoony. It's like one of the only times I can think of like a fan outcry. Like imagine if they were like tried to like postpone the Ghostbusters like all female cast to try to make it actually funny. And it's like, sorry guys, yeah, we really messed up on this. We really shouldn't have done this. But like at least this guy right here, he was willing. He's the director of the film. He saw everybody react on Twitter. He's like, you know what? We're going to try to fix this. We're going to try to fix the design. But you know what? The design isn't the movie, okay? Granted, that's a big part of the movie is how Sonic looks and how he moves, how he talks. Huge part. But the story is, like, really essential. Like, unless they're going to, like, shape up the story, because we don't know the story. We know Jim Carrey's in it, playing Dr. Robotnik, I think his name is? I don't know.
Eggman.
Eggman, yeah.
Eggman, Dr. Eggman.
So, I mean, if in the words of a man, George Lucas, back when he made sense...
Oh, let me say it. An effect without a story is a boring thing indeed.
Yes, absolutely. Unless it's Godzilla, then it's incredible. But any final thoughts on this real quick?
I don't think that's going to save this film.
Do you want to see Sonic the Hedgehog movie at all?
Unless it's got Knuckles in it. And I tell you who I want to do the voice of Knuckles. The guy from the Old Spice commercials.
Oh, the dude that's like, look at your girlfriend, look back at me. And
No, let's pull that back. How about they get Ice Cube?
Danny DeVito.
Nah, Danny DeVito. You got to have someone more ethnic to be Knuckles.
Hey, he can do ethnic. He can do anything.
That's true. He did do Pikachu a lot.
He's like Frank's Red Hot. He goes good on everything. He just adds a nice kind of spice, a vinegary spice to everything. It's like he just kind of cuts through.
Oh, yeah.
Danny DeVito does everything. Hunter Baker is rolling around his grave. Is he dead? No. But he might be. He sleeps in weird places. But, yeah. Guys, thanks so much for watching so far. If you have any comments, questions, or concerns, you can leave them at facebook.com/studio67ncc. We'd love to hear what
you think. Terry Crews.
I knew you were going to say Terry Crews.
I was thinking about you. Yeah, Terry Crews would probably be the perfect match for Knuckles.
Yeah, Terry Crews. I can see Terry Crews doing that. But thank you so much for watching. We're going to take a really quick break. When we come back, we're not going to be reviewing Aladdin because, Tyler, it sucks.
Yeah, it's terrible.
And I didn't see it.
It's just bad. No
yeah.
Good.
We're going to be looking at an interview clip from something that I mentioned at the beginning. What is it? You're going to have to stay and find out.
It's not Aladdin.
When it comes to culinary arts, Nash Community College is here to turn your burning passion for food into a career. Our chefs, with over 70 years of highly qualified industry experience, are here to point you in the right direction, teaching and handing down classical culinary techniques that will improve your skills and help you cut your way into the food industry. Gain invaluable experience, vital to cooking and preparing delicious food, served in a personal and creative environment. To learn more about the culinary arts program, visit nashcc.edu.
Oh, static. Guys, how you doing? This is Isaac, this face doesn't do anything for me, Anderson.
I am Tyler.
And welcome back to Big Bang Cinema, guys. So, as mentioned before, we're not reviewing Aladdin because Tyler sucks.
It's terrible.
Yeah.
4 out of 10.
You never scored it. Yeah, 4 out of 10?
4 out of 10.
Is that all you give it?
4 out of 10.
I thought you would give it much lower than that.
4 out of 10.
But instead of a movie review this week,
it killed my childhood.
I don't think that's true. George Lucas did that a long time ago. But I got to sit down on Skype with a man named Tom Proctor. Now, Tyler and I know who Tom Proctor is, but in case you don't know, Tom Proctor is an actor. He's a stuntman and he's a musician. And most of us know him as Horaz from Horaz, or however you pronounce it. It's the U. It's Horaz. You know who he is. He was in Guardians of the Galaxy. He played Django Unchained. He played in Looper. He's in a lot of things. When you see his face, you'll probably know who he is. Anyway, here's a short clip of my talk with him. Here you go. Trailing a little bit away from the songwriting, I'm greatly enjoying talking to you about the music and the songwriting. You seem very passionate about what you do in all these regards. But most people will probably recognize you, if they don't know your music, probably from Guardians of the Galaxy. It's probably the biggest thing that you've been in. You've been in a lot of great things. You've been you did some stunt work in Looper. You've done you were in Justified. You know you you were right next to Michael Rooker in that movie, and you have quite a few scenes in that movie. Like, tell me, what was it like working on the set? Did you get the were you like second unit, or like was it just, did you get to work directly with James Gunn? And like, you're right next to Michael Rooker.
Yes.
So, I mean.
And let me tell you something. James Gunn is an amazing, amazing, so far beyond amazing director. He knows what he wants. He knows what to get. See, if you look at the movie, I was originally supposed to be Blue with the things, and they took time to do all this prosthetics and fancy contacts and everything like that for me. And when we were out doing the rehearsal, they said, okay, we did a rehearsal, nobody's dressed or nothing like that. And James Gunn says, no, I don't want prosthetics on him. I don't even want the contacts on him. He's intense the way he is. So all they did was enhance the scars that I already have. They just made the scars that I have, I have a lot of scars on my face from having such a charming personality. And, yeah. and uh, you know, so they just enhanced those, and that's it, and walked through it, and it was, he runs an amazing set, and it was really funny, because I thought first off, when you do a show like that, you don't, even on the audition, you don't get the real sides.
Yeah.
You don't get to know. Guardians of the Galaxy was the first movie I've ever done where I went to the movie and didn't know the ending because I never got the whole script.
Wow.
I never got the script. Matter of fact, we would get handed our script going into the soundstage and had to turn it in on the way out.
Wow.
So I'm sitting there thinking that, you know, green screen, I've done green screen before. I think in the ship is going to be a chair, maybe a couple of sticks, and it's on a green screen, and they're going to put everything else in, right?
Yeah.
So I go in there, I walk in, and the whole damn ship is there. I mean, it's more like a flight simulator. There's no acting involved here. I can see right where the raccoon thing's coming from. I can see right where the ship is supposed to be that I'm shooting down. I walk back to James Gunn. I said, that's my ship? And he goes, yeah, that's your ship. I said, that's Jorge's ship. And he says, yeah. I says, you better rewrite this something. Because if that's my ship, I said, I'm going to kill everybody and take over the Marvel universe.
As far as the character that you played in that movie, was that something that he had a very specific idea how he wanted you to play it? Or is that something that he gave you the free rein to try to come up with yourself? Or...
He had a very, from the audition point, he had a very specific idea, you know, as he put it to me. I said, is there something different you want on this? Said, no, he says, big, ugly, and intimidating. This is what the Juarez is. Matter of fact, on the audition call thing, initially the call said no one under 6'4".
Yeah.
He wanted somebody who could intimidate Michael Rucker. And, you know, and I'm only 6'1". And, you know, we told casting, I said, you know, I'm only 6'1". And casting says, yeah, but I've seen your audition. You bend the ground when you walk. And so, you know, she was, they were pretty excited about that.
You've been in a lot of great things. I was just wondering... are there specific things that draw you to certain roles? Like, do you go there specifically because this director that you know, like you trust them and you're really excited about it? Are you really story oriented and you gotta, you know, you like to see these kind of beats in there? Like what makes you decide on taking a role?
Okay. I've had a lot of people ask me this, and I pick a role on the great stories and also its impact. I've been the racist white guy in almost every slave movie, 12 Years a Slave, Birth of a Nation, Underground, the series, Django, it is because that is a deal where I feel like those are stories that need to be told, as brutal as they are. They need to be told, and the only way to make people comprehend the need for change is to justify the bad guy. If I go in and play the racist white guy like I'm a bad guy and that, then people say, oh yeah, he's a bad guy. No need to change that. He knows he's a bad guy. It's a bad guy. But if I go in convinced that I'm right, that I have a right to sell, brand, or kill these slaves as though they were my livestock, and I can convince the world of that, then people will say, you know, that's just messed up. That's wrong.
Yeah. And those movies that you were in do a very, very good job of doing that. You as an actor really portrayed that very well. You know, it's just, yeah, as difficult as they are to see and, you know, and relive, you know, it's very necessary to kind of, you know, to see that and not try to play it like, you know, necessarily the villain, but somebody that was just doing something that they thought was, you know, correct and something that they thought was right. You know, I thought you do a really good job of that as an actor. Man, you've done a lot of great things. We wish you the best of luck in doing all these other things you got coming up. You know, we absolutely love what you do. And so if people want to actually find you like on social media or whatnot, and just kind of keep up what you're doing, where would they find you?
I'm just Tom Proctor on Facebook, Tom Proctor Band on Facebook, at Tom Proctor, Tom Proctor Films on Twitter, and Tom Proctor Band Instagram. All good places. And if you notice my hesitation, as I'm not sure of the names because I don't know enough to even set that stuff up. I mean, people set that
up.
You
leave that to more, you know, like managerial hands kind of things.
Yeah, they set it up, but then I go on and just talk to really awesome people. I have a lot of actors that say, I don't even do my own Facebook and I don't even do my own Instagram. And I think, man, you have no clue what you're missing.
That sucks. Like, it's a direct connection to the fans. Yeah.
There's awesome people out there.
Before we go, we do have a movie show, if you can't tell by the movie posters behind me. I'm a big fan of film. I love film. And I was just wondering, I ask all my guests this, and I thought this would be a good one for us to end on. What is your favorite movie?
That I've been in, or my favorite movie?
Just your favorite movie in general. You don't have to necessarily have been in it, but like it's, you know, just one that you absolutely love that you would consider one of your favorites, if not your favorite.
I'm sorry, but Roadhouse.
Oh, that's not a bad one, man. That one's fun.
Yeah, Roadhouse would be right up there with my faves. You know, and I got a bad case of Batman syndrome, so things like Uncommon Valor and those are kind of my favorites.
Roadhouse! Guys, thanks so much for watching. We really do appreciate it. Let me make sure my mic's unmuted. It's not. That's probably why you guys couldn't hear me. I said Roadhouse. You can probably hear me through Tyler's mic. Just things we do.
Mm-hmm.
Guys, thanks so much for watching. For real, really appreciate every single one of you. Thank you to Tom Proctor for sitting down with me and talking all about his career. If you guys want to see the full interview, you can go to facebook.com/studio67ncc. Watch the full thing. It premieres, if you're watching this live, it premieres right after this at 4:30 right here on our Facebook page and on 89.1 Big Bank Radio. And it's going to be there all the time you guys want. It's also going to be on our YouTube page, youtube.com/NashComCollege, in case you guys want to see it ever again, because it's a great one. But next week, instead of a movie review, we have a interview with Mr. Josh Schaefer. Tyler, you know who Josh Schaefer is?
Yeah, he's on Dave Letterman.
No, that's not him.
He's the ball guy who plays the drums.
That's Paul Schaefer.
Oh.
He plays the drums. He plays the
drums,
piano.
Keyboard. He plays all.
He plays everything. Yeah, but Josh Schaefer is editor in chief of Lunch Meat Magazine, which is a VHS culture magazine, and he actually got to sit down with me yesterday and come up here all the way from Raleigh and talk about a VHS culture, how it started, all these different weird VHS movies and that he knows about. And I don't want to spoil it for you. It's a really cool segment. Thank you to Josh for coming up here, and that's going to be airing next week. We look forward to giving that to you. Mm. And, yeah, anyway.
And next week I'll be talking about Godzilla.
Next week, for a few seconds. I don't know, we have a lot of stuff in the show next week.
We
talk a little bit about Godzilla. We'll put a little bit in Godzilla because I think Godzilla's worth talking about, okay?
Yes.
Okay, anyway, guys, thank you so much for watching. My name's Isaac. This face doesn't do anything for me. Anderson.
I am Tyler Keene.
Stay lovely.